Peace TV English, the solution for humanity.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Merciful, all praise is due to Allah, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His Prophet Muhammad, His family, His companions all, and all of His followers until the day of resurrection. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Peace be with you. I'd like to welcome you to this continuation of the series Human Rights, a Muslim Perspective. I've already covered in this series all of the important issues regarding the history, the significance, the sides of human rights, the violation of human rights in today's world. And also I talked about the Muslim perspective as I see it of human rights. And I've already come to the issue of caring for those who are at disadvantage, particularly in times of conflicts and war. And we need to remember what has been said of the Muslim khalifas and rulers throughout history regarding the directions to commanders in the field, that in times of conflicts with enemies, obviously they don't need to cut trees, not to loot, not to abuse the power they have at hand, particularly to those who are non-combatants, including the women who are non-combatants, the elders, the children, the sick, and the worshippers in their own monks, churches, and synagogues, and other temples of worship. And then there is the sanctity of the human being, whether this human being is alive or dead. Even for the dead, we have to care for this person, making sure that he is kept with his dignity and honor even after he passes away. Now, coming to the most important aspects of the human rights in the Muslim perspective, which is all rights, freedoms, and duties are bound by the Sharia. They are bound by the law of Islam. And obviously, this Sharia has to be interpreted according to the sources of this Sharia, namely the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, based on the interpretation of the specialized scholars. So it's not in the hands of anyone to do that, including rulers. They have to depend on very well-versed, specialized scholars who know what the rules are and how to be interpreted. So all of this is the guardian against the misuse of human rights or the twisting of human rights, either to the advantage of those who are in authority or those who are probably somewhat influenced by foreign ideas to Islam. We understand that there are many common things between Muslims and non-Muslims in regards to human rights, but still, in some areas, some issues, there will be some difference. Let me make some comparison between the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights. And we find that there are many areas of agreement between the two. And let me be frank that the wording and the formulation of the issues presented in the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights was somehow influenced by the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Not necessarily the topics, but the formulation, the wording, putting things in a particular order or style. That was obviously influenced by the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was ratified on December the 10th of 1948. And since then, that has been the day of human rights where states, organizations, and human rights societies are supposed to educate the public about human rights, to make people aware, to celebrate this in such a way as to advance the cause of defending human rights in every society on earth. Let me talk about some of the points of agreements, which are so many, but I need to go back over these points one by one, starting with equality of people in their original status as dignified human beings. Every human being is born in dignity and honor and shall be respected and shall maintain that status unless they go out of bounds and unless they commit terrible crimes or they have to face penalties set by laws in every country. Now, in the Muslim context, we're talking about Sharia. Secondly, there is this equality in enjoyment of all the rights in front of the law. And in the case of Muslims, in front of the Sharia, the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's also the agreement in right to life and the prohibition of abortion. And we know that abortion, which means to abort a child from pregnancy, no one has the right to abort that child because it's a human being and it's killing a human being, which is not right for anyone. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who decides what is right and what is wrong and who gives life and who takes life. So this is important. Another point of agreement is the right to good reputation and dignity, because again, a person has to be protected from injuring his honor, injuring his reputation as a decent human being, unless proven otherwise under the law. There is also the right of forming families, because the family is the basic unit of any society. And every human being has the right to form a family under the law of the Sharia in the right way to marry. Now, we understand that marriage has to be maintained according to the law in every particular religion or culture. In Islam, they have to be free from any reason for them not to marry, such as when they are engaged with another person in marriage, except for a man to marry more than one, which is up to four women. Again, with justice being practiced, and if this person is in any way assuming not to practice justice, then it's prohibited for them to marry more than one wife. Even for one wife, a person has to maintain justice and to be very careful not to cross boundaries with the rights of their own partner in marriage. So that is another right. The rights of women and their equality with men in terms of getting their human dignity, in fulfilling their duties towards Allah and towards the society. And obviously they have their own independent personality. They have the ability to conduct financial matters on their own. But obviously in Islam, once a woman is a daughter, then she has a right towards her parents, just like a man has the right, has the obligation of being kind to parents, and so on. But again, if she's in the status of being, for example, a wife, then there are certain rights for her as a wife, and there are certain responsibilities for her towards the husband. But we understand that she is equal to man in respect to the duties, the dignity, the honor, and the respect that she deserves as a human being. The right of children in being cared for morally and physically. Every born child has the right upon his parents, the relatives, and the society and the state to care for, to make sure that this child has the right environment of bringing them up, of discipline, of physical care, because they are in need until they are mature enough to understand what to do in their own lives. Also, the right of a mother in her life, the right of a mother upon the children, the right of a mother for caring for her and for her children. The right of parents, in fact, is also guaranteed by both the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Islamic Declaration of Human Rights, and the rights of anyone caring for the children, such as the parents, in choosing the way to bring up their children, provided that they do it in a very reasonable way according to some traditions, but without hurting anyone, without infringing upon the rights of others. I need to stop here. I will have more to say on these issues, so please stay with us.
Thursdays provide.
In Britain, we are facing one big problem, that are you Muslim or British?
The space to talk.
In India, back home, they ask, are you a Muslim first or Indian first? And we Muslims should know how to reply, how to turn the tables over.
The place to knock.
Why Trinity cannot be regarded in that sense, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
The opportunity to ask.
But even if we agree that what the Christians say, that he was crucified, so if Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, died for 3 days, who controlled the world? That means even God died?
The freedom to unmask.
So there are various ways which we can prove the argument to be wrong.
Let's meet Dr. Zakir every Thursday at 6:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 9:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV. The children of Islamic International School. Different, outstanding, extraordinary.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
if Allah helps you, none can overcome you.
There is no God worthy of worship except Allah.
Allow the Quran to come into life. It will enlighten you.
Islamic International School inculcates excellent educational goals and achievements.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said,
best amongst you is the one who learns the Quran and imparts its knowledge to others.
Islam will enter everywhere.
For the best in this world as well as hereafter.
This book is answering all your problems.
The glorious Quran is the solution of problems of humanity.
Watch Khadija Sayyad, Yusuf Serran, Ayman Ansari, Ahmad Soratia, Nabiha Khan, Naif Ansari, Zahra Patanwala, Arsh Zagare, Ghazi Chauhan, and Farik Naik.
Allah is giving us an opportunity to do a prophet's job and to earn a prophet's reward.
Watch Tides of Islamic International School speak on challenging topics in Promising Generation every Saturday at 7:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 10:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. I'm back with you and continuing to address the issues of differences and agreements between the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Universal Islamic Declaration of Human Rights. And we've already covered some issues of agreement. There are still some more to agree on. For example, the right of a person to be responsible and to issue or ask for responsibilities from others. A person has that right. An individual has a right in education, in full education. This is the right of the person, particularly in childhood, until they reach a very good age where they are to find a decent job, to work and earn decently. This is important. The right to freedom. Of course, everyone is born as free, and they have the right to work, they have the right to choose, they have the right to decide. So that is all agreed upon by all rights and documents and declarations of human rights. The right of the individual in the movement and in seeking asylum. When you say the movement, to transfer from one country to another, to go and seek a job in any place in the world. The right of a person to work and to choose the type of work, provided that this work is safe. And safety has to be maintained in the places of work. This is the right of the individual not to put them to any danger, anything that would influence their safety, security, and health. Also the right of people to have property, to own, and of course there is no right to confiscate their properties or belongings unless by law this is the case. So that is what is needed. In fact, we have to always refer to the law in order to somehow restrict these rights that are given. Also, both declarations talk about the importance of benefiting from one's production of intellectual material, the copyrights of an individual in whatever he has produced, such as books, writings, papers, any production of form of art, media, communication, anything of intellectual production would have to be, of course, the right of the person to benefit from, and it's his under the laws of copyrights. The right of the individual in providing an environment that is moral and clean. Clean in the sense that they should not infringe upon the value system of these people. So all people have the right in providing that environment that is conducive and suitable for their own moral standards, provided that they are reasonable and welcome. And if there is more than one value system in any particular culture, it should be maintained and respected. The right of the individual in seeking good livelihood in all aspects. So a person cannot be restricted to a particular field of work or earning. Person, as long as they meet the requirements, have the right to do so. Also, every individual has the right for personal security, religious security, family security, financial security. All of these are important. So the individual security and the security of the work, of the family, the environment, the place where this person is obviously very needed. The person also has the right to be independent in their own dwellings and in their own family, and the right for them to communicate whatever they have and to express this clearly, which means that the dwellings of human beings are a sanctuary, and therefore they cannot be, of course, transgressed against. Even the state doesn't have the right to inspect, to enter any home, any dwelling, without a prior and legal notice from the bodies of the judiciary, such as a court, in order for them to, if they have enough evidence to reason, to go and inspect, if that is for the safety of the general public or the safety of the individuals residing in that particular home or dwelling. The right of a person to seek asylum and to seek fair trial. The important thing is that the guards for human rights come basically from the judiciary and the judicial system. If that is found and everyone will resort to the law and to find that their rights are maintained and their rights are guaranteed not to be somehow in any way taken from them, wholly or partially. This also goes to the right of enjoying freedom from accusations, because everyone is innocent until proven guilty. That is the basis for all the human beings. Every human being is supposed to be free unless they are proven guilty, or we do have a strong evidence that this person has committed such crime. That's why sometimes this may create somehow a loophole for some people to step on the rights of others. They may take the rights of others because they are shrewd enough not to leave any evidence, because, you know, sometimes those who try to commit some burglary or theft or some kind of a mischief action, they will try not to trace anything that will somehow lead to recognizing who the criminal was. But of course, most of the time, somehow Allah will disclose them, and somehow they will leave something behind that may lead. Even after years, we have seen crimes being committed against others, such as when someone, as the case was reported in one country, where a group of women were kept in one house against their will for 30 years. But after some time, this was disclosed. So no matter how long a violation of the rights of others would last, but at the end, they will be coming to this end and they will be disclosed. Even if this does not take place in this life, it will take place in the hereafter, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will disclose it in front of everyone on the day of judgment, before every human being who was on this earth. And it's even worse than to do it in this life. That's why we do have this guard of self-consciousness. And depending on your faith, if people are decent and they are resorting to their own natural tendency of being good and decent, obviously that will save them a lot of trouble. Another type of agreement between the two declarations of human rights agreed upon by the United Nations and the Muslim countries is the right of freedom in your own conduct in public life. And of course, the prevention of any torture or anything that would demean the humanity of any human being, and the prohibition of taking humans as hostages. And we have seen terrible incidences of where human beings were used as human shields or hostages in times of conflict, or for some groups who seek some political gains, and they use these tactics in order to put some pressure on the governments or some other bodies in order to make their point. This is absolutely prohibited. Allah does not like this, does not want anyone to be hurt when they are innocent, and no one has the right to take others as hostages or as human shields in order to fulfill their particular needs. And we've seen terrible, terrible examples where these people were probably hurt or even killed in crossfire, or when they were taken hostages, and still because the authorities, such as the police or the military, will have to do something, and sometimes they will have to even step in and go for the criminals. So, obviously, we know that to begin with, this is wrong and it's not allowed. And no states shall do this, and no group or individuals in any way shall commit this wrongdoing. This is one of the worst things that we've seen in our lives. This reminds us of how crude and bad some people are in their own view of human life and their respect of human life. But we know that criminals do not value human lives, particularly when it comes to putting others to this type of danger. I will have more to say on the agreement between the two declarations of human rights in Islam as well as in that of the United Nations. But until then, I leave you with Allah's care and protection. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ya wasi' al-afu, ya wasi' al-afu, wal-ghufrani wal-karami, qad jirtu murtajifan min zallati al-qadami.
Scientific notions in the glorious Quran are among its endless aspects that can testify for the divine nature of this noble book. These scientific notions are probably the best addressed to the people of our time.
I am Zaghloul al-Najjar. Please join me in this program to discuss some aspects of the scientific notions in the glorious Quran.
Appreciate the word-to-word authenticity of scientific notions and proven facts mentioned in the glorious Quran 1400 years ago in Scientific Notions in the Glorious Quran. Every Saturday at 8 p.m. and repeat telecast at 8:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV. Friendly message by Dr. Zakir. The most profitable business.
Would you like to know the business in which you earn the maximum profit? The secret is given in the glorious Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261. The example of those who spend their wealth in the way of Allah is like a seed of grain, which grows 7 spikes. In each spike is 100 grains. And Allah multiplies His reward to whom He wills. If you spend your wealth in the way of Allah, you'll get a return of 700 times. In business terminology, you'll get a profit of 70,000%. Is there any business you know of in which you'll get a better return? Invest today in the way of Allah.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.